magnetic field due to an infinitely long wire. Okay, so for infinitely long straight wire, for infinitely long straight wire means if we want to know the magnetic field due to a current carrying wire which is infinitely long straight wire, but lengthwise it is infinitely long, then how can we find the magnetic field due to such wire at a distance a from it, right? So if this is be the current I carrying along the straight wire, and let the wire is infinity at both ends, the wire is long enough so that it is infinitely long, it is taken up to the infinite distance from the point from where the shortest distance is defined as a, let P be that point where we need to know the magnetic field. Okay, so our basic formula was mu naught I by 4 pi a cos theta 1 plus cos theta 2 dash. If you remember this format, if the straight wire is of finitely long, if the straight wire is finitely long, then geometrical position of the angle used in general formula, it was theta 1, it was theta 2 dash, this was theta 2, this was alpha, this was beta. Do you remember this? And this is the distance A from the point P, provided if this is current I. So based on this geometrical status, when we use the geometrical angle of theta 1 and theta 2 dash, then the magnetic field value at the point P due to this current carrying straight wire of finitely long, that is of a certain length, can be written mu naught I due to this current, magnetic field at P, that is mu naught I by 4 pi A into cos theta 1 plus cos theta 2 dash. I think this was the formula if you remember, right? Cos theta 1 plus cos theta 2 dash. Or otherwise, this result can also be written as mu naught I by 4 pi A. Okay, this is sin alpha plus sin beta. So if I can write down the magnetic field at P due to the current I in the conductor for the distance of the point P from the wire as A, this represents the value of the magnetic field at P due to this current. Magnetic field will be inward, at P it will be inward, and the net magnetic field value will be this. So when this straight wire, when this straight wire becomes infinitely long, then what will be the change in geometrical position? So far as these angles are concerned, where we can see the change in angle, the change in angle will be taken place like this. Theta 1, when this will be infinitely long, that means when this end will be taken to infinity, theta 1 will become tends to 0 degree. Because as you take this point to infinite separation, this line joining will become almost parallel to this conductor itself, and this theta 1 will, because as you can see, if you increase the length, the value of theta 1 goes on decreasing, this will turn to be 0 degree. This will be the one change. Change of alpha, that will change to 90 degree. Alpha is increasing, it can maximum 90 degree when this end is taken to infinity, right? Similarly, on the other side, beta, that too will change to 90 degree. theta 2 dash, that 2 will change to 0 degree, and if you talk about theta 2, then it will become 180 degree. So these are the change in angle that can be possible when we consider the wire instead of being finitely long, if it becomes infinitely long on both ends. If it is at infinite distances, if ends are at infinite distance from the shortest position from where the distance of the point P is measured, then these are the permissible change in angle, and hence the magnetic field at P, that will be mu naught I by 4 pi a. If I use theta 1 and theta 2 dash, then it will be cos 0 degree plus cos 0 degree. So cos 0 degree is 1, so 1 plus 1 2, so it will be mu naught I by 2 pi a. You can check it by using other form of the magnetic field expression. If you want to know the magnetic field at the point P by using other form of deciding the magnetic field value, that is sin alpha part and sin beta, using this part also, alpha is changing to 90 degree and beta is also changing to 90 degree. That means sin 90 plus sin 90. So that 2 will become 2. So when sin alpha and sin beta both changes to 90 degree each, the result, this part will become 2. So final answer will be mu naught I by 2 pi a. When straight line, that means when straight wire will be infinitely long, and importantly, when we say it is infinitely long, that means both ends must be infinite separation from the shortest point or from the point where we need to know the magnetic field. In that case, it will be mu naught I by 2 pi a. But there can be a different result. There can be a different result if the wire is said to be infinitely long, but both ends are not infinite distances from the required point. Though if it is considered it is infinitely long, but still both ends are not infinite distance of separation from the required point D. Rather, one is at the closest distance and another end is at the infinite distance, then result will be something different. Could you follow what I mean? When the wire will be definitely infinitely long, but in spite of being infinitely long, both ends are not infinite distance of separation from the required point. That means that condition says that But this time the wire is definitely infinitely long, but one end is at finite distance from the required point, the other end is at infinite distance. So when ends, both ends are not at infinite distance, then again to get the result of magnetic field under this condition, we need to use the geometry and the related formula. So see what will happen. When I am saying that one end is at closest distance from the required point and the other end is at infinite distance from the required point, that means we are talking about this. So that if this is be the required point, one end can be, for example, if current is still going this way, this end is at infinite distance and this end is at the closest distance. That is the mean of saying closest, because obviously the required point won't be on the conductor itself, it will be away from the conductor. So if I still consider the distance of separation of the point P from the conductor is, in general term,
this was the case.
For example, when I will take one end to this point, watch me carefully. When I will take one end of the wire at the closest distance, from the another diagram, if this end is taken over here, then theta 2 dash will increase, and that will tend to 90 degree. Beta will change tend to 0. And when the other end is taken to infinity, then again theta 1 will become 0 and alpha will be 90 degrees. So magnetic field now at P can be written mu naught I by 4 pi a. If you use the sine alpha plus sine beta form, then one angle will be 0 degree, other angle will be 90 degree. Got my point? Sine 0 is 0, sine 90 is 1. Mu naught I by 4 pi a, correct. Previous one was mu naught I by 2 pi a. I made it wrong. Previous one was mu naught I by 2 pi a, right? This one will be mu naught I by 4 pi a. Either you use sin alpha, sin beta form, or even if you use cos theta 1, cos theta 2 dash form, right? In cos theta 1 will be 0, theta 2 dash will be 90 degree. So one part will be 0, another one will be 1, fine. Now, if I give more specific condition of it, if it is infinitely long, but the condition is given like that, this is A, this is A by 2, and this end is infinity. Current is carrying this way. What will be the magnetic field at P now? Given the diagram in such a way so that the one end is at finite distance but the other end is at infinite distance, then what will be the magnetic field value at the point P due to the straight wire carrying current I? If I join the end with this, taking this angle alpha and joining it to the infinite end at beta, and if I want to use magnetic field at P as mu naught I by 4 pi a sine alpha plus sine beta, right? I'm using this form for example. So using this, I can write down mu naught I by 4 pi a. So here sine alpha will be this by this. This side will be under root of a square by 4 plus a square. That means this can be written root under 5a by 2, right? So sine alpha will be a by 2 by root under 5a by 2 plus beta is of course 90 degree. So this is mu naught I by 4 pi a, okay? This part is definitely 1 by root 5 plus 1. Are you getting this? Okay, fine, very good. Then your answer is absolutely correct. The answer for this magnetic field at P is based on, as far as this diagram is concerned, it will be this. I'll give more situation so that we can understand the exact use of it. Now, for example, this is the point P at a distance A. Now, the conductor is exactly this one. This is the one end M, the other end N is at infinity, right? Undefined point. So, this is the wire itself. Now, the wire is M to N. M is the finite end. M is the finite end, right? And the other end is at infinity. Yeah, this one is A, this one is also A. One by I couldn't hear you properly. No, there is a mistake. See, again compare with the general form. When the ends are at, if this point is, if ends are at on either side about the point which is the foot of perpendicular measuring by the length which is the shortest distance from the required point P, if we draw perpendicular on the wire, then when points are on either side, for example this is M, this is N, in that case see alpha and beta are on either side like this, then we get it plus. But when both ends are on the same side, when both ends are on the same side like this, got my point, then it will be minus beta. If beta on this side is plus, then alpha will be minus. In this case, magnetic field at P will be mu naught I by 4 pi A. This is sin beta minus sin alpha. Got my point? When alpha beta are on the same side, that means both ends of the straight wire is on the same side from the foot of perpendicular deciding the shortest distance, then one angle will be plus and other angle will be minus. So it is will be sin beta, because beta in this part remains plus, the positive part of alpha is now downward, so it will be minus alpha, right? So then we must write down, this is mu naught I by 4 pi A. Obviously, being it is infinitely long, again sin beta will be 90 degree, this is sin 90 minus. Obviously, if these two angles are same, that means alpha is 45, so sin 45 degree, right? So it is mu naught I by 4 pi A. Okay, sin 90 is 1 minus 1 by root 2. This will be the result as magnetic field at point P. Is that clear? All the four sides of the square frame is formed with wire having uniform resistance. Now if I current enters into the loop at A and it leaves at the corner D, then what will be the magnetic field at the center of due to this square frame? If all sides are equal in length, equal resistance, then what should be the magnetic field value at the point O when current enters into the loop at junction A and it leaves the loop at junction B? What will be the magnetic field at the point O? What will be the magnetic field at the point O when the loop suggests that current enters into the loop at one point and it leaves at some other point? Yes, the net magnetic field at the center will be zero, because AB, BC, CD, these three wires will be in continuation, so current will be flowing continuously through this three wire. So total resistance in this part will be 3R if I consider R to be the resistance of each part, right? So this is 3R and this is R. Potential difference from A to D remains constant. Either current flows from ABCD path or directly from A to D. Being potential difference constant, current will be inversely proportional to resistance. So if this is resistance in the upper part is 3:1 with this, so current will also be reciprocal, is 1:3. So here the current will be 1/4 of the total current, and here it will go 3/4 of the total current. Got my point? So the portion ABCD, ABCD, for this portion magnetic field at O due to ABCD will be inward, and B at O due to AD will be outward. And they are equal and opposite. They are equal and opposite. So since they are equal and opposite, so net magnetic field will be definitely zero there. Is it clear? If I ask you to know the magnetic field for these two infinitely long wires, those who are carrying current I each, what will be the magnetic field at P, provided P is equidistant from both the wires and the wires are infinitely long? This is infinite wire. Okay, this one is also infinite wire. The cross is indicating the direction of current. The position of the wires are definitely perpendicularly into the plane of the board, right? The wire's position is perpendicular to the plane of the board. So that's why for a line perpendicular to a writing plane cannot be shown properly. So it can only be shown with inward or outward convention. So being current going inward, so I have shown it by the symbol of cross. So the wires are parallelly placed, having separation of 2A. P is a point where we want to know the magnetic field. Correct, it will be zero, because magnetic field for this part will be B1 this way, because current is going this way. At magnetic field at P, it will be downward. And similarly for the second wire, that 2 is carrying current inward, magnetic field at P will be upward. And in fact, B1 will be equal to B2. Both are due to infinite wires at distances A each. So it will be mu naught I by 2 pi A. So net value of magnetic field at P is definitely zero. Fine. Now, for example, if I ask you to know the magnetic field, if I want to know the magnetic field for these three wires, all three are carrying current I each, and they are at distances A each. I want to know the magnetic field at P, such that this point is A, and if I name these positions of the wire as such as A1, A2, A3, okay, A1, A2, A3 are the positions of the wire. All three wires are perpendicular to the plane of the board, P being the midpoint of A1, A3. What should be the magnetic field at P then? Fine. See, all three are infinitely long, so magnetic field value magnitude wise due to each wire will be mu naught I by how much? 2 pi A. Right? Do you agree with me or not? Pardon? No, I mean distances will be different. I am saying about the format will be mu naught I by 2 pi A format, right? Okay, fine. So for A1, magnetic field at P due to A1, right? This I will write down this magnitude. It is going this way, so this is this. Let this is B1. I am writing this as B1. Okay, this is equal to B1. So this value will be mu naught into I by how much? 2 pi into a by 2, right? In the direction I am showing it, right? For A2, this will be the distance and magnetic field will be this way. This will be the direction of B2, that is magnetic field at P due to A2, which I can write down at B2. So that will be mu naught I by 2 pi into this distance. See, this is 60 degree because all together this is an equilateral triangle. 60 degree, this side is A, means this side will be A sine 60. So this distance will be root 3 A by 2. So it is into root 3 A by 2, right? And then finally, magnetic field due to this, that is magnetic field at P due to A3, which I can write down B3. So this will be, this is outward. So that too will be in the downward direction. So B3 will also be this way. Okay, magnitude of B3 will be mu naught I by 2 pi into A by 2. In fact, B3 and B1 are equal, right? So B3 and B1 are equal. So net value of magnetic field at P will be under root of square of this value plus square of this value. This value is twice of mu naught I by pi A whole square plus square of this will be, which is this, so that will be mu naught I by root 3 pi A whole square, right? Are you getting me or not? This is coming this way, so out of which the common term is mu naught I by pi A. I can take it out, mu naught I by pi A, taking it this much is out of the square root, and rest part is 4 plus 1 by 3. 2 square will be 4, 1 by root 3 will be 1 by 3, 1 by root 3 whole square. So this is how much? 13 by root 3, root under 13 by 3 into mu naught I by pi A. This much Tesla or Weber per meter square must be the answer, and it should be somewhere this way. This is the net magnetic field at P.